Yeah.
Oh, anyway.
He's winning.
Because everybody talks about doing this.
You don't happen to know who asked about it?
Hello.
Do you want to tell me anything about the quarry?
It's bad. It's bad. Let's stop it.
There we go. What about you?
We're pro-environment, not anti-quarry. We're really trying to protect the Niagara Escarpment.
Exactly. What little we have left of it.
What little we have left of it. You know? So it's very important that we do what we do.
There we go.
We're Maude Barlow's front line. That's what we told her that just a minute ago.
For vitamins, minerals, and hormones. How can they...
They don't do it when they're prescribing drugs.
Thank you very much for coming out this evening. My name is Tim Green. I'm faculty here at Georgian College. I teach in the School of Liberal Studies, such courses as environmental concerns and ecological citizenship. A big night tonight, actually, and we've had a wonderful day for it. I was quite tempted to wear some shorts today. What did we get up to today? 15? Was it 15?
It was 30 in the sun.
30 in the sun.
That's right.
On March the 7th. It's incredible. So I'm glad that we had a good day because we started planning this event in September, and my one fear was, I looked at the date, oh my goodness, March the 7th. You know, we could have a snowstorm, we might have to cancel this thing altogether. So none of those worries today. Again, it speaks to Maude's character. This is Maude Barlow. Do not listen to those who say there's nothing you can do to the very real and large social and environmental issues of our time. There are serious problems that beset our world, but there's so much room for hope. And there's such a need to bring joy and excitement to our commitment to a different future. The life of an activist is a good life because you get up in the morning caring about more than yourself or how to make money. A life of activism gives you hope. Hope is a moral imperative in this world. It gives us energy and it gives us direction. You meet the nicest people, you help transform ideas and systems, and you commit to leaving the earth in at least as whole a condition as you inherited it. What really amazes me about this quote, and what I think it's worth quoting that, is we never hear our leaders, Stephen Harper, Dalton McGuinty. How come they're not asking these questions? How come they're not providing us with hope? Should our leaders be? Should they be asking? What does give us hope? What gives us a deep-seated human joy? What sort of a future do we want? Do we want a future that looks like today? No, it can't. There is no future in an economy that's based on greed. It doesn't recognize the limits of the Earth's living systems. The moral imperative that Maude offers us, and she is correct about this, is that we should create a future based on the simple idea of leaving the Earth's living systems intact and fully functioning. Principles of courtesy, respect, kindness, community, these are not new principles. But our culture certainly has lost sight of them.
Well, I thank you very, very, very much, Tim, for such an absolutely lovely introduction. Very moving and very beautiful, and I deeply appreciate it. And thank you to you and David Berryman and all of the team at Georgian for the opportunity to be here and to share this with you tonight. And by the way, when you say I do you the honor of signing books, there's not an author alive who doesn't love signing books. Just a little hint. In fact, I knew somebody who said that Pierre Burton used to come in and not alone and go into bookstores and sign all the books. And so the joke for him was that if you found a book that he hadn't signed, it was... So we're here to talk about a quarry that's not going to happen. I've won some and I've lost some in my life, and I like winning better. But I thought I'd start off with just to remind us about the global situation that we're dealing with, because I think it's very important for us to remember that we are in fact part of an ecology of a living ecosystem, and all parts are connected to all parts. So I just want to give you some of the latest. So what we know is that we are dumping, for instance, massive amounts of land-based water from rivers, lakes, watersheds, aquifers, into great big thirsty cities, and think, you know, 20, 30 million people in some of them. And if they are anywhere near the ocean, and most of them are, they dump that water into the ocean instead of returning it to the land. Again, another new study tells us that about a quarter of the cause of rising oceans is not climate change as we have understood it through, you know, about greenhouse gases, gas emissions and so on, but is the displacement of land-based water into the oceans, where it's lost to us as fresh water. And so the supply is going steadily down and the demand is going steadily up, because as we add many more people to the planet, we also know that our consumption of water is growing at twice the rate of population. Again, and I won't throw too many more studies at you, but this is one that was done by the big bulk of water industries and the big food industries, and coordinated by the World Bank. And they said at current rate of extraction, by 2030, the demand for water in our world will outstrip supply by 40%. Now, it's hard to get a handle on that. And today we heard this wonderful announcement from the UN that they're reaching their millennium goals on drinking water, and they're so happy, and it's just so not true. It just really upsets me to see it in all our papers as if it's true. All they're counting are the number of pipes they've put in, so they can say we've doubled the number of pipes. Whether there's anything coming out of those pipes, or whether you can afford to buy what's coming out of those pipes, or whether those pipes are anywhere near you, none of those questions are asked. Nor are the questions asked about the deep extraction, over-extraction of these water sources. So we are talking about parts of the world not experiencing drought. We hear the word drought, but actually running out of water. Scientists call them hot stains. They include the Middle East, 22 countries in Africa, all of northern China, many parts of India, other parts of Asia. Australia has hit the water wall. Mexico City is sinking on itself. Huge parts of the United States are in crisis. The Ogallala Aquifer, you know, that was the aquifer that became the center of the controversy about the Keystone Pipeline, and why Obama did, in fact, temporarily stop it. That aquifer used to be the biggest groundwater source in the world. It's probably depleted about half now. But the U.S. Department of Agriculture put out a statement recently saying it will be gone in our lifetime. The biggest source of water once in the world will be gone in our lifetime, likely. For sure. What they said was it's not a matter of when or if, it's a matter of when and how we adapt. And this is the water that grows most of the food used and enjoyed by Americans. We are seeing the desertification of our Earth. There are 4,000 cities in China in danger of being overtaken by the desert. And so we're seeing over 100 countries losing the fight, the so-called drought fight. So it's very important for us to know that it's not just cyclical drought, that we are a planet in this kind of conflict or crisis. Now, it is creating conflicts. There are many of them. There are now nation states, big powerful nation states, and big hedge funds and investment funds going around the world looking for sources of water. I was just in Brazil not long ago at a conference on the Guarani Aquifer, which is the other huge aquifer in the world, which is now probably considered the biggest. And there are four countries that sit on the Guarani Aquifer, and I said, it's going to be plundered so fast, you can't imagine. I told them these statistics and said, you're sitting on one of the biggest supplies of water in the world, and you do not have adequate protections for it. But we also have what are called land and water grabs, where huge parcels of land, for instance in Africa, land twice the size of Great Britain has been bought up by these hedge funds, by richer countries coming in because they want to have somewhere to grow their food. So this is the water and the best land is being used to grow food for export back to the home country or just to be put on the open market. And we also have the conflict between big cities, thirsty cities, and nature, wilderness, rural communities, and First Nations, Indigenous areas. Indigenous peoples are the first to have their water stolen, to be displaced from their land for their water. to have their water polluted and so on. It's a huge issue. I just had the honor of speaking at the first conference on the, by the Assembly of First Nations on the right to water. It was in Edmonton 2 days ago. And we talked about how Indigenous peoples here in Canada and around the world are on the front lines for, you know, move over. You're sitting on resources we want. And then, of course, the issue that I've been so deeply involved in, and that is the question between whether water is a commons and a public trust and a human right, or if it's a commodity to be put on the market for open market for sale. And I don't know who's going to win that fight. I am watching Europe with great distress. Their austerity measures mean that they're selling off water systems, all of the water system in Greece. In Italy, when Berlusconi was prime minister, he announced several years ago that they were going to privatize all the water systems, and the people were so upset they held a referendum, overwhelmingly voted against it. European bank said, doesn't matter, you're going to privatize it anyway. Madrid yesterday held a referendum, non-binding, because the government wouldn't recognize it, fighting their privatization. Of the people who voted, it was well over half, 98% voted against privatization, but it doesn't matter because there's another set of dictates out there in the world, right? So whether you want it or not, the system now is going to tell you we have to move to that that corporate model. And now we're seeing places converting water licenses to water, they call them water rights, but they're basically property. And then they buy and sell that property, and it's destroyed the water system in Australia. I mean, Chile holds public auctions where Canadian mining companies come in and they bid against local indigenous communities, farmers and so on, and they outbid for the water, and they are allowed to physically take that water away or dump their toxins in it or whatever. Alberta, unfortunately, is also looking at water markets. It's the first province, but we think British Columbia will follow soon. So the struggle is on in our country as well. So that brings us to our beautiful country and our beautiful province here. We have what I call the myth of abundance here. Until a couple of years ago, if you went to the Environment Canada website, you would see that we had 20% of the world's fresh water. This is not true unless we were to drain every lake, river, and aquifer and make us a desert. We have 6.5 to 7% of the world's fresh water, available fresh water. That's the water you can use without destroying the base. We have a 42-year-old National Water Act. It's pathetic. It's really outdated. We have no national drinking water standards. The condition of drinking water and sanitation in First Nations communities is appalling in this country. We have not mapped our groundwater. We don't know how sustainable it is. We build these trade agreements and other economic policies based on the notion that there's unlimited water, and that isn't so at all. We dump our toxics. There are now, in a recent study, they found 204 toxic chemicals in the Great Lakes alone. And won't get off onto the Great Lakes, but I won't come back, but we are launching a campaign to have the Great Lakes called, named, accepted to be a commons, a public trust, and a protected bioregion. And there's a report on our website called Our Great Lakes Our Great Lakes Commons, and we're very keen to get people talking about alternative ways of seeing these precious waters, because our Great Lakes are in trouble from over-extraction, invasive species, non-point pollution. Now there's energy, the tar sands. You know we won Keystone for now, but what you might not know is there's another pipeline called the Alberta Clipper, already taking the dirtiest, worst energy fossil fuel in the world by pipeline to 17 refineries on the US side of the Great Lakes. So this is not a place to be refining the heavy oil from the tar sands of Alberta, but here it is, it's hitting our Great Lakes. Now, Ontario, I'd say, was confused. I would say that there are strains of good. There's an attempt on the part of some and some legislation to do some good things here. And of course, there's our Clean Energy, the Clean Water Act, which empowers local communities to take action to prevent harm to their local water sources and requires public participation at every step of the way in any new project that impacts water. So we do have the beginnings of some good work here. On the other hand, we have the Open for Business Act, which McGinty brought in several years ago, which basically sees water as a resource to be used to lure water-intensive business to Ontario. You see it all around the Great Lakes. I mean, some really blatant advertising in some American cities about, you know, have the workers come up from the south and the southwest and come here and we'll give you preferential access to our water and preferential water rates. So the message is really mixed here in Ontario. Basically, we get the McGinty government using our water to promote access to companies like the bottled water industry. They are on their website quite positive about the bottled water industry. Massive development of rural communities. I really worry about Simcoe County and what's going to happen here. This beautiful, not just the quarry, but I think that if you look at what the plans are, you start to see a stakes and ladders board game with the sources, the water sources being used to come into all these industries and communities. And this myth of abundance, I think, is very real here when it comes to giving the green light to projects like the quarry that we're here to talk about tonight.